Our political editor, Andrew Clennell, joins us. The coalition, Andrew, is facing challenges over the costs for its nuclear plan.
Well, they've got to come up with it, don't they? And they say we'll do it well before the election, but it's going to make things sticky if they don't do it in the next sitting fortnight. Now, the Prime Minister's about to speak. I did flag on Sunday agenda that he might have a climate-related announcement this week. That could be a neat segue into nuclear. Maybe he's just out there to get his lines up in nuclear ahead of question time today, which promises to be fiery. But yesterday, I thought it was interesting on Sunday agenda, Nationals leader David Littleproud didn't come at a Tanya Plibersek suggestion that it would be $387 billion to build their seven power plants. The CSIRO's previously said $8 billion per plant. Last year, they said if you built the coal-fired station power equivalent, that would require 71 small modular reactors. I've cleared this morning. Ted O'Brien said yesterday they'd have more than one modular reactor on each power plant site. Not sure if they're building 71, though, but I thought David Littleproud would kick that into touch. I thought he would say $387 billion's an exaggeration. He didn't. And I thought that's really intriguing. It's becoming clearer that the reason that Peter Dutton didn't mention the cost when he made this announcement last week is it is a ginormous cost. Let's have a listen to the Environment Minister and the Nationals leader yesterday.
We'll be very clear those costings will be upfront and honest, and there's international experience where you've got established nuclear power plants up and running where you can benchmark and look at the moment. So those costings will be delivered.
We're saying we've announced a policy without costing it. Like, when has an opposition ever gone to the Australian people with something as fundamental as saying we're going to slam the brakes on renewables, we're going to move to nuclear instead, and they've done it without a costing? I mean, seriously.
Tanya Plibersek, she says your nuclear power plants are going to cost $387 billion. What do you say to that?
Well, that'd be a fraction of what their plan by 2030 of 82% renewables would cost. It's $1.5 trillion, and that's Net Zero Australia who's articulated those numbers. And then $7 to $9 trillion between 2060.
You didn't even flinch, though, when I said $387 billion for your nuclear power plants. Is that in the ballpark?
Well, we'll be very upfront and clear about the costings and about the scale and capacity of what nuclear energy will firm up. There is an upfront capital cost. This is something the Australian people will own. And so there's a big difference about the upfront costs and the dividends that it'll pay back over the life of the assets.
It is getting tricky, and you're right, he didn't flinch. But what did he signal about subsidies for solar, Andrew?
Well, we didn't rule it out, and I've got a hint on this that as part of their broader energy policy they're putting out in coming months, solar will be part of it. And it would be extremely popular to provide subsidies for getting solar panels. I think a lot of us would lean towards getting solar panels if they were subsidised by government. So if you're serious about generating electricity once coal gets phased out, why not? And I think we'll get that. We'll get more announcements in terms of gas. But do they do other things in terms of government ownership? It's fascinating, really, to think what else is in this energy policy. David Littleproud here not ruling out the prospect of solar subsidies being promised by the coalition. There is more of this coalition energy policy, I understand, to come. Does that include money for solar subsidies for people who put solar panels on their roofs?
Yeah, well, look, obviously we're exploring all the options in terms of everything outside nuclear, because if you change the mixture of the grid, then obviously that pathway has to be credible. We'll be unveiling exactly how we intend to get there and the mechanisms and the costs of which to achieve that.
Possible
solar
subsidies.
I'm not putting any possibilities in or out. No scoop today, mate, but what I will do is say that we will make sure that we responsibly look at all the options to protecting our agricultural land, but understanding renewables will play a role, that gas will have to play a role.
Tanya Plibersek isn't ruling out a climate trigger as part of her environmental reforms.
Yeah, she's put this out in stages. The argument's been, which she denies, the mining and resources sector have meant that she's been more cautious on her approach in these long-awaited reforms to the EPBC Act. Business are concerned that as part of this act, even with the safeguards mechanism in place to force business to act on climate, that she'll include a climate trigger on her approvals because the Greens and the crossbench will demand that for Senate support. Now, I was shown a quote from late 2022 on Sky News where Tanya Plibersek ruled this out as a consideration. She wasn't doing so yesterday morning. Would you rule out a climate trigger as part of those reforms?
I have said that we are open to further discussions about how we reflect the impact of climate change in the third tranche of laws. People have every opportunity to have a look at that very closely when I release the exposure draft of the legislation, before anybody is expected to vote on it in the Parliament.
It sounds like there'll be a climate trigger perhaps then.
No, as I said, we're still negotiating on the third tranche of legislation. It's a big and complex job, and I'm not going to... We're getting the second tranche through the Parliament at the moment. That's my focus.
Andrew, another cracker show. Thanks so much. And, of course, you'll be standing by.